Lord, we thank you for your word to us. And we know sometimes that word brings us hard teaching and great challenge. You empty our hands of that wealth of unneeded things we cling so tightly to, that you may fill them again with your grace and hope and love for others. So as we reflect on this encounter, help us all to know that one thing which might be holding us back from following you into that life which Jesus offers each one of us. Amen. The text for my sermon today is Mark chapter 10 and verse 21. Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." The rock singer Meatloaf had a song that had the lyric, "I would do anything for love, but I won't do that." And so it was with this rich young man. The encounter is there in Matthew, Mark, and Luke's gospel. He came to Jesus with great eagerness. But the challenge that he met in Jesus meant that he went on his way with great hesitancy. Jesus' demands left this young man shocked, appalled, mournful, and forlorn. Like the camel in the story, he had the hump. And it could have been so different, but he made his choice that day. Thinking about him, it came to mind that he is an almost Zacchaeus. You remember the story of Zacchaeus who met with Jesus, who had an invitation from Jesus, "I'm coming to your house for tea." And so he opened up his home and opened up his heart and changed his way from getting and cheating to giving generously. He is an almost Zacchaeus. But he faltered at the moment of decision. For him, the pearl of great price, Jesus, just wasn't worth the asking price. He was rich, but he couldn't afford the cost of being a disciple. He wanted for nothing, but he didn't want Jesus more. "I would do anything for love, but I won't do that." And in this scene, this rich man with perhaps an entourage with him would have stood out in stark contrast to that ragged band of poor fishermen and their travelling rabbi, Jesus. Was he rich enough, perhaps, to own a number of properties or successful businesses and even own slaves to work for him? Here was a man who was held captive, possessed, we can say, by his possessions. Consumerism, the desire for wealth, consumed him. And Jesus that day wanted to release him from it all. Sell what you own. Give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. It must have been a shocking demand and a mysterious one. What is treasure in heaven? But it was the call to let go, to relinquish, to live in this world as if you owned everything but possessed nothing. And we might say that this would include selling his slaves and restoring their freedom. And didn't Jesus come to do that? If he had had the courage, and which one of us here today would say we would have perhaps chosen anything different, knowing what he knew about Jesus then. For Jesus said about not building a tower unless you can complete it. So don't start the journey of discipleship unless you know you can complete it. And we remember that that's in the background of this story for us. You know, I don't want to be too harsh on him because I can see myself in him, and perhaps you can as well as you think about your life. But if he had the courage on that day to be obedient to Jesus, then he could see his wealth do so much more. Not just serving him, but think about what it could have meant. Transforming lives for the better. His charitable giving could have put food on the table for the poor, could have provided housing and work and so on. And wouldn't he have been blessed to see that wealth released in that way? His small, tiny world could have opened up into a generous enterprise and brought happiness and freedom to others and ultimately to himself. For surely the joy of investing in people far outweighs the joy of selfish gain. But he couldn't quite take that step, that, well, more than a step, a leap of faith. The door to eternal life was just too narrow. He couldn't squeeze through with all his stuff. He couldn't leave it all behind. And here we see the danger. It stands as a warning to us all, doesn't it? There is a risk. Love things and use people. Or use things and love people. And it's that latter that God calls us to do. Don't love things and use people, but use things to bless and love people. So that we are a channel of God's blessing and it flows out from us. And we're not like the Dead Sea that is salty and dead because it has no outlet, but that it flows out to others. And really what it comes down to is this. The one thing that the rich young man lacked was love. It was love in his heart. Yes, he was respectable. He was God-fearing. But did he have love in his heart? Did he know what it was to be loved? Did he feel loved, or did all that stuff kind of replace love in his life to give him a meaning and status and purpose? But we know it's not the amount of stuff we have, it's what's in our heart that makes us rich in the eyes of God. But Jesus knew his heart. And in that wonderful verse we heard, Jesus looked at him and judged him, condemned him, no, loved him. Jesus loved him, willing him to change. Jesus called him to love people, but he couldn't quite do it. He was almost like Ebenezer Scrooge, but remaining in chains, not having that will to have that final change of heart. I would do anything for love, but I won't do that. Would I? Would you? No wonder that Peter, the disciple, in that moment spoke up and thought, well, Lord, we've left so much behind. What about us? And Jesus says, yes, I know you've left everything, but what you've left is nothing compared to what you will gain in this world. Family, brothers and sisters. Perhaps he was thinking of the wider church that they would become part of. Properties, churches, establishments, mission houses, everything, it would all be part of God's kingdom, their wealth. And with it, he says, persecutions. And that cuts, doesn't it? We don't want to hear that word in the things that we're going to get as disciples. Persecutions, a cost to being a disciple. But as you come here today, you will know that you have paid a price to follow Jesus. There will be some cost to your discipleship. And thinking about it, would any of us, if right at the beginning when we first met Jesus, he said, this will be your life and these are the things that you will have to trust me with, things that you might have to let go of, hopes and dreams that you will have to reassess. And with them, he said, persecutions. And that was just telling the truth, because that's what happened to these disciples. They received persecution. And it still happens today. We think of David Amos today, who was a Catholic Christian. Think of the cost and the persecution he has received, and his family, for doing his work, for trying to do the kingdom work of a politician. So it's a hard teaching today. It's a grown-up gospel. A hymn writer put it like this. Jesus calls us from the worship of the vain world's golden store, from each idol that would keep us saying, Christian, love me more. What claims your highest loyalty today? What is that one thing more the Lord is asking you and me? Today, are you open to be challenged by this call to follow Jesus? Where will it take you? What will your yes cost? And what will be the reward? Not just in this life, but in the life to come. God is faithful. And we have that vision of the life to come, those treasures in heaven that will not compare to all that we try and grasp in this world. Will you let God today remove any hardness or greed or barrier in your heart and mind today? That hurdle that prevents us following Jesus wholeheartedly. That we might go from here in freedom to hold more lightly to the things of earth and to hold more strongly to those treasures in heaven. And most of all, today to know that just like this rich young ruler, Jesus looks on you with perfect love today. As we sang, over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me. I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. He loves us into change. May we be filled with the love of Jesus as we make our response now in our song. Overflow, that we might put the gifts that God has given us at the service of the poor, the stranger. We'll never know what became of that rich young ruler. I wonder, did he have a change of heart at some time? Did he have a change of heart and seek Jesus out and make a decision? We don't know if he accepted the call of Jesus on his life, on his riches. But our response, well, that is in our hands. That is in our hands. May he give us grace to answer his call and respond in obedience. For his glory. Amen.
The chorus of the song that we're going to sing says, I will love you, Lord, my strength, and I will love you, Lord, my shield, and I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love you, God. So we're going to use this song as our response, saying, yes, we choose to love you, God, before, above all things. So I invite you to stand if you're able as we sing.
God, that you.
Seated as Lord and King of all. Amen. Now Pat is going to please come forward and lead us in our time of prayer for others. Thank you, Pat.
Before I commence my prayers, I'd just like to say that I will be praying for a young man called Andy Hall. He was he is the son of one of our previous ministers, and he is very poorly with COVID in a hospital in Austria where he lives. He's in an ICU unit, so I just wanted to give you the background for him, and we think of Andy and all his family at this time. So shall we pray? Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power, the glory, the majesty, and the splendour, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. You created such beauty on this earth, Lord. We pray that when the leaders of the nations meet together, there will be a genuine desire and determination to do all possible to halt the decline. Bless those individuals and companies who are endeavouring to find ways to cut our carbon footprint. We pray for those in the world fleeing their homeland, having no roof over their head and dependent on others for food and clothing. We also bring those in this country and the world who are facing despair, starvation, fear of violence, and poor health. Father, we also pray for those who are grieving, especially since the start of the COVID. We also pray for the family of Sir David Amos and all other families who suddenly face the loss of loved ones. Lord, we think of the Queen and all in government, especially at this time. Thank you, Lord, for the large amounts of food that is being given this harvest time through churches and other sources to REACH and other food banks. Thank you for the finances that you provide through supporters for the ongoing work. Bless REACH and other food banks that they may be able to bring hope and relief to so many. We pray for those working in the hospitals, care homes, and the community. Please give them your strength, energy, and peace of mind as they work tirelessly. Thank you, Lord, for the young people in our church and for the work of our Sunday school staff. So many children and teenagers in the schools are in need of support and help during this time. Bless Sarah and other Christian teachers as they work with them. We pray for Open Mind, Next Door, Town Pastors, Lantern. Please bring in the workers, Lord, to serve the community. We thank you for answered prayers for many of our church family, but we especially ask your blessing upon those who are grieving and those suffering serious health problems. We lift up to you those that are on our hearts at this time. We especially ask for healing for Andy, for strength for his wife Olivia and their two small children. We pray for your wisdom and strength upon Peter as he takes extra responsibility within the district whilst Reverend Pursehouse is on sick leave. We thank you for your promise of your glory and power upon this place in the future. But now, Lord, we pray that we will serve you with enthusiasm, compassion, and love. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we say the Lord's Prayer?
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We thank you, Pam, for leading us in those intercessions today. Our service will be followed by refreshments that are served in the church hall, and we hope that you'll be able to stay and share with us. A reminder that the Faith Time deadline is today for contributions, please, to David Frost. Is there something that you can bless others with in next Tuesday's Faith Time? Thank you. And also, we thank those who've brought shoeboxes filled. And we can see a few at the back there that have been filled, or people have donated things to go in a shoebox. And we thank you. And isn't a shoebox a reminder just how wealthy we are? For some who will receive a shoebox and their whole world will be contained in that. It's a reminder of how blessed. So please keep those shoeboxes coming in. We've gratefully received them and keep them here. And then to just finally say, our prayer ministry team are available and they wear a green lanyard. If you would like to ask for prayer in a quiet place in the church afterwards, they would love to do that with you. What Jesus offers is more valuable than everything that we could have in the world. That is our vision as we go from here. So let us make our final hymn our prayer today.
Stand to sing.
Let us pray. With nothing we came into this world, and with nothing we shall leave, except love. And so with love we dedicate these gifts, and the gifts made by standing order, and all the blessings that we enjoy, dedicated to God. Help us, Lord, with whatever we own, with whatever we do, with whoever we are, in this week ahead, to make a loving response to your great love, our Maker, Redeemer, and Sustainer of all. Amen. Let's say together the words of the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.